Welcome to the Dork Forest. Jackie and her pals will never bore us. Shameless confessions
about our obsessions
will make us laugh and smile. So let's explore the Dork Forest and dork out for a while.
Hi, it's Jackie Kashian. Welcome to the Dork Forest. You've chosen wisely, Rangers. DorkForest.com, TheDorkForest.com. JackieKashian.com for everything. And AllThingsComedy.com is the podcast network that I'm part of. It's a podcast network. They have comedy videos. It's really great. Started by Al Madrigal and Bill Burr, and there's a million great podcasts over there, including Baron Vaughn and Aaron Foley. This episode of The Dork Forest is sponsored by Audible. Audible.com. That's right. It's an audiobook. I love an audiobook because sometimes I'm driving in my car forever. And I've been a member of Audible forever, and they said that they would advertise, and so I'm going to tell you about it. A lot of people offer. You can get it anywhere, probably, the free month of Audible and a free book. Well, if you're going to do it, I say do it from audiblepodcast.com/dorkforest. And I would recommend that you get Eiffelheim from Michael Flynn, which is a great science fiction, historical fiction. The history is amazing. Dark Ages, so cool, and read to you. So it's kind of a smart book, and I really liked it. I also like all of Sarah Vowell's books done on Audible because there's so much research into it. It's a little textbooky, very funny, very smart, and even better when she reads it. So audiblepodcast.com/thedorkforest. And now let's get into this episode, which is great. Hey, I'm here in New York City. Get a rope. That is a Pace commercial reference. I don't know why I said it. Jackie Kashian here. I'm here with Kevin Seccia. We're going to talk about fighting. Hi, Kevin.
Hello, Jackie. Thank you for having me.
You're welcome. I haven't seen you probably in 2 years. Used to live in L.A. and do a lot of stand-up comedy there. And then you moved here. When did you move to Brooklyn or New York City?
I moved here about 3 years ago.
Okay.
Three long years.
So I probably haven't seen you in 3 years.
Yeah. It's been a while, buddy. It's good
All
to
right.
see you.
It's nice to see you as well. You know what I find interesting about New York City? More people call me buddy than, I don't know.
I think you'll find that's been my influence over the past 3 years since moving here. Prior to that, you didn't find a lot of it.
You didn't find a lot of buddy talk.
There was hey,
a
pal, lot of,
pal.
Chief.
There was
compadre.
You know, I do enjoy chief. That is perfect. It's it feels like I'm in charge of something.
Always inappropriate.
Always inappropriate. Always fantastic. So I'm just in town doing the Podfest and then stand up comedy. You live here like a person.
Well, let's not exaggerate. I exist here.
Right. So it's at Kevin Seccia on Twitter, right?
Correct.
And
yeah.
KevinSeccia.com.
Yep.
Are the two main things.
Yeah.
And you're writing a book.
I've written a book.
The book is done.
Yes. It's out. You can buy it.
Oh, you know what I asked Aisha Tyler when she was on one time?
Uh-huh.
What have you been doing since Talk Soup?
Oh.
I said to her. And she just looked at me and she was like, stop talking.
Did you redo that one? Or you just kind of
No,
going,
no.
Or?
Just let it go. I'm
okay.
The Huell Hauser of podcasting.
She warts and all. Why bother?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Mm-hmm. It's one of the reasons why people listen to podcasting is so that they can hear you. Well,
unvarnished,
in my case, the unvarnished truth of the information I don't have.
Yes, exactly. Yeah.
I have a lot of information. I'm not going to say I don't. But what I don't have is all of the information on anything.
You can have bits and pieces. Chunks.
Yeah. I can go a little bit into the past.
It's been 3 years, so I can cut you some slack. You know?
Right. Because I know that you were doing the book, and I loved the blog, and so I'm glad they turned it into a book.
Yeah. I continued to exist while I was not within your sight lines.
It's turned
into this weird thing where...
How is that even possible?
My life continued. I know.
You kept going?
It was a surprise to me, too. I thought, like, the shadow would fall, and then that's it. But it was just, like, nighttime for me.
Right.
I woke up the next day.
You woke up the
Jackie-less.
Next day. And I emailed you and said, do you want to be on the podcast?
Yeah.
And you said, yes, I like it when people hit each other, and I want to talk about that.
Boy, do I.
Do you?
I mean, that certainly is not the ideal way to phrase it, but
No.
I do. I do enjoy fighting in various forms.
Because you took boxing, if I remember correctly.
I did.
You have studied some boxing.
I've studied some boxing and some martial arts when I was a kid. And
right.
I've proven to be not proficient at any of it. but I remain a fan.
Thoroughly enjoyed it?
Yes, I did enjoy it.
All right. That's, yeah. I think that that's all you can ask.
Absolutely.
Of anyone's, you know, I enjoy hacky sack. I am not good at it. I like the look in your face of confusion.
I mean,
because I don't look like a hacky sack player, but I do really like
it. No, that wasn't it at all. It was just more the idea of being good, as if you could go along a path similar to like a fighter or an athlete or...
Oh, you could. We'll have a hacky sack.
It's more of a circle, though. You're not really going up. You could be the best hacky sacker in the world.
Right.
Still,
it is not as competitive.
Not exactly
it's more of a, it's more of a cooperative game. It's true. It's, it's more of a pandemic. Kind of. All right.
Devil sticks? Do you toss them around?
Devil sticks? I am not a juggler at all.
Oh.
Have never enjoyed juggling. Don't even actually like watching juggling.
I feel like there's three moves, and if you've seen them, you know.
You have to be... we're all jaded when it comes to magic and juggling, where we've seen some people juggle sharp items, and we've seen heavy items, and a heavy item, and a really light item.
You've run the gamut of, yeah, those are some items.
Right,
we've seen them. A squishy thing, a hard thing, rectangular thing. Oh, I'm so sick of the shapes.
An eating thing and a non-eating thing.
Yeah.
And we're if you're going to do it now, you have to, you really have to bring it to really get me involved.
You have to throw up like a pregnant woman and then two babies come down and the now non-pregnant woman.
Ooh.
And you keep juggling.
Yeah, I would actually pay to see that.
Yeah.
The last thing I saw that was fascinating was I think I saw a guy balance an 8-foot table on his chin.
All right, yeah.
That
I would
was
see
something
that
else.
One time.
Exactly.
I had like a bit that was sort of a ripoff of this, but it was like sword swallowers are the same thing.
Yeah.
Like they have a row of swords going up incrementally, larger and larger, and they start off with a small one. And it's just like, I get it. I understand you're going to make your way through over the next 20 minutes all of those swords. It's no longer exciting. Just light one of them on fire, and I can get to my car. You know what I mean? Like, right. I understand it's all right. Equally off-putting.
Right, and you can still have the $18. It'll
yeah.
be fine. Because I don't know how to do that, and you're doing something I don't know how to do. It's
yeah.
exciting.
It's the first time. It's exciting.
Right.
It doesn't amplify.
So if there's a juggler out there that can explain to me, I mean, because I did have a guy on who juggled, and he talked about the art of juggling and why he did it and how much he enjoyed it. And I was supportive of that, but I want to know why he thinks it's still a thing people should go see, besides the fact that he loves it so.
I want to know why you think it's a thing to put a juggler in a visual medium on an audio podcast.
Oh, right.
Was he a hell of a storyteller?
He was a hell of a storyteller. It was Jesse Schell, he's a TED Talk video game designer.
Oh.
He's an amazing
That's
guy.
That's two strikes. Juggler, takes part in TED Talks, and
wow,
murders people.
That's
no.
it. We're going to... No, well, he creates the... Did you ever... I played Punch-Out. That was the only boxing I've ever done.
Oh, yeah.
I played the video game upright Punch-Out.
That was a great game, and then they became Mike Tyson's Punch-Out, and...
Were there extensions on it?
I think the video arcade game was Punch-Out, and then they modified it to where...
For the console.
Yeah, and then that was Mike Tyson's.
Well, and I bet you there's a Wii version or a movement version.
I think there is. I
yeah.
don't. I'm not familiar with it, but.
But you yeah. watch like the only boxing I saw when I was a kid was my dad on Friday nights would turn off the Tarzan movie I'd be watching, so that he could watch a fight.
Wait, you grew up in the 30s, right?
I grew up in the 30s.
Buster Crab was
That's
Tarzan.
It. I used to have a bindle, and I would head out to rural Wisconsin.
I love the idea of this. That the old Tarzan flick would be playing the Jungle
every
Fiction.
Friday. Johnny Weissmuller Tarzan movies would play.
Okay,
over and over again. By the
yeah.
way, they didn't care. They didn't care that they already did it. It was pre-DVR.
Yeah.
So
they ran some of them backwards. He's like going the wrong way. On
we
the
had a VCR too, and we could have recorded it, and then we were the first people on the block.
Oh,
have a VCR
yeah.
and a microwave. Very glamorous.
Fancy stuff.
Fancy yeah. stuff. I don't like to talk about my youth and how wealthy it was, but yeah, we had things. And my dad was constantly, only because my dad was, wow, I'm going to let you talk at any minute now, but the...
Friday Night Fights.
Friday Night Fights.
Remember it. I think there were various iterations.
Mm-hmm.
Am I using that correctly?
Yeah, yeah.
And is that, in fact, the word?
Yeah.
There was, I think, an earlier the version you're referring to, which I... watched a little bit, and they brought the show back about maybe 15 years ago. But
okay.
Yeah, it's a great show, and they're always like lesser budgeted than like your big pay-per-view HBO stuff, but it's like a good weekly showcase for boxing.
Because it's professional boxing, but at like a lower level, like an A-ball kind of situation? Or
Yeah, it's guys who are about to kind of make their debut on the grand stage,
okay.
or guys who are about to be knocked unconscious by the guy about to... realize his dreams.
Is it the open mic of, is it sort of more one-nighter run kind of, but better than that?
It is. It is yeah. very much like, not open, I would say it's like the equivalent of like a Comedy Central spot or something. I remember even actually, back in the 90s when I was more doing stand-up, I trained at the Freddie Roach's Wildcard Gym in Los Angeles, and there was a guy there.
That's a great name, Freddie Roach.
Yeah, and I was a fan of him. This guy there, he was a local guy, and he was an electrician by day.
Okay.
And his name was Ernie Zavala, and he was like a young up-and-coming boxer, and I was at the time like a young up-and-coming comic, and I remember we both got like, The Late Late Show or something.
Right.
Like nine hosts ago.
Right.
And he got ESPN Friday Night Fights, and it was such an interesting sort of like, hey, look at us. We're doing well.
A parallel to...
And it is sort of a similar thing. And it's such a harder existence, though, because like as bad as my career has gotten at times and highs and lows,
right.
I've never suffered a setback in front of 100,000 people where I went unconscious. That is certainly the risk there. Yeah, his career, unfortunately, kind of petered out. Like, he did two or three more of those. He lost that fight, two or three more, and then you're kind of done.
Yeah.
Which is unfortunate. I'm just going to take it into a sad direction.
Well, no, that's okay, because I think boxing has to be harder than stand-up comedy, just because of the punching.
Yeah.
Yeah.
We both walk that aisle alone. We both have those little butterflies. And then someone is punching you in the face numerous times.
Right. They're not just yelling drunkenly at you, and then you leave going... I hate that lady. And then you do another show the next night. Instead, that lady were to essentially jump on top of you and start pummeling you, you'd be like, no, I really hate that lady.
Yeah, absolutely.
And yeah, that'd be entirely different. So
brutal.
So what were your first... Now, you like boxing. Boxing's your dorkdom. And UFC?
Yes, I'm a big fan of... So UFC is the league name. It's... I'm
Ultimate
a
fighting?
Dork, which is prohibited. It's mixed martial arts is a sport name. It's sort of like a Kleenex tissue type situation there. Yeah.
So mixed martial arts is the sport. UFC is the brand name like NFL or something.
Correct. And there are other ones. There's Bellator. There's the World Series of Fighting. There was a defunct Japanese one, which was my favorite, which is called the Pride Organization.
Okay.
And so, but UFC is the big one. Yeah.
Okay. So mixed martial arts, that's not kickboxing?
It is. It's sort of a combination of all other elements, and the stuff that didn't prove to be useful was kind of dropped, and the stuff that was like further incorporated. So it's like wrestling, kickboxing, boxing, jiu-jitsu, judo in some cases, and it's like a hybrid of that. And guys have their strengths and weaknesses, and women as well do it. And it's the same kind of thing. Some people have their strengths, but you have to be able to do it all pretty well.
And is it you can use any of those things?
Yeah.
Or, I mean, like, if you show up with a jiu-jitsu move, it's not against the law.
No, there are certain standard...
There's got to be rules.
No, there
are
definitely rules. There's, like, you can't, like, stick your finger in someone's eye. You can't kick them in the junk.
Right.
You can't hit in the back of the neck. But as far as how you throw a person to the ground or strike them, you can pretty much do whichever you want for whichever discipline.
Correct. So if you can grab them and throw them on the ground, that's viable.
Yeah.
Okay.
That's a legit thing. Yeah.
So it's not like, because boxing, you have this whole thing where you're wearing gloves and you're dancing around and you can't hit below the belt, but you can't.
Well, all that's true for mixed martial arts, too.
Okay.
You are wearing smaller gloves, these little 8-ounce gloves, but there is dancing around. There are people who are, if you look at them, it looks very similar to what a boxer would do. But then occasionally they will take someone down or get taken down.
Leg sweep.
You're on the ground.
Cobra Kai.
Leg sweep. There you go.
All right. Yeah.
But it's similar, but there's a lot more options, which is exciting.
And you've been watching, and you've been following that for a long time.
Yeah, since the beginning, pretty much. Like, UFC 1 was, back during the 90s, was a sort of a one-night tournament. It was like the beginning of the sport.
Really?
It wasn't technically the beginning, but it was
mixed
in terms
martial
of American
arts only
exposure.
Has been around since the 90s?
Yeah, it's a very young sport, which is part of its appeal, because it's still... It develops at like a much quicker rate than, I mean, baseball is pretty much baseball, and it's been that way. Even boxing has been boxing for hundreds of years.
Yeah.
And with mixed martial arts, it's like you'll see things that worked a year ago no longer work because the learning curve is so fast and new athletes are coming in and people are training in all aspects of it. As opposed to in the beginning, it would just be like a karate guy who learned how to like stop a takedown. And then a jiu-jitsu guy who would just try and take you down. But if he was standing up, he would be screwed.
Can you see those old fights on YouTube?
I believe you can. Yeah.
That'd be really cool is to watch some of those old fights and you're like, wow.
Yeah, I remember watching them and thinking it was fake and then thinking, like, there's such an education in terms of the ground game because I think there's an aspect of it that would appeal boring to the average eyeballs. But, yeah, once you, it's not that complicated. It's not chemistry. You know, once you learn the few basic moves, it's easy to follow. And it's still ultimately two men trying to destroy each other.
Right. Right. And so now why, I mean, I don't watch, I've seen some boxing and I'll, if it's on, I will follow it. But you, I mean, I
don't lie to me.
No,
you leave it on. You're not going to. You
no,
would watch?
No, I will. I will cycle. If I will say this, if Hoarders were the other choice and Chopped were the other choice, I would watch boxing.
Okay,
just because I don't like Chopped. I don't like. I'm like, yeah, show me the thing they're making. Stop talking about it.
Yeah,
yeah.
All right.
It's too. At least boxing moves at a relatively.
Yeah.
I mean, there is some downtime when there's a lot of dancing around, where they're not hitting each
but
other.
But there's also like, sleeping. Who doesn't like sleeping?
Is there sleeping?
When somebody gets knocked out, it's sleeping.
Oh, right, right. Yeah. Is that what? So, what are the terms? Is that a term? Is that like I'm putting that guy to sleep?
That is certainly
from the
been
30s.
Used.
Yeah.
No, you would
used.
Hear that. You would hear that yesterday or tomorrow.
Okay.
That's totally a viable term.
Yeah. People are still calling it as they see them.
Yeah.
So, who are your favorites? Who were your favorites in the day, and then who are your favorites now?
My favorite boxer of all time was Roy Jones Jr. You've never heard of him?
I've never heard of Roy Jones Jr. When did he box?
Who have you heard of? I'm just curious.
Muhammad Ali.
Okay. He was pretty good at boxing. I can understand
why
his fame would have reached the wide masses. Okay.
Right. He was, I remember as a tiny child, and this is racist, no doubt. I thought he was the Hank Aaron of boxing. Because I'm from Milwaukee.
See, I don't know what Hank Aaron means other than I know he's baseball, but I don't know what he did in baseball.
He's the greatest baseball player of all time, and he played for the Brewers. And so that was a big deal when I was a kid. And people were like, Muhammad Ali. And I was like, oh, so he's like the Hank Aaron of boxing.
Wait, why is that racist, though?
Because they're both black, and I probably got them mixed up because they were black. But I also...
Yeah, but if they both happen to be the best of their sports, then it's just...
This is also racist. I got Cary Grant and Rock Hudson mixed up as a child. Also racist. Both dark-haired white guys.
That is no way is that racist. That is a child seeing similarities. Physical
that's
similarities.
Exactly what,
that is
that's what racism
is. No,
that's
no.
all that racism is.
No.
Is a child seeing
everybody's
similarities.
Everybody's racist.
Yes. Anyway, so...
No, I would say... okay, so Muhammad
Brown,
Ali...
The brown bomber? Joe Louis?
Yes, correct.
Is that correct?
Yeah.
I don't know why I know that.
Okay.
And then... That might be it. And then that the
your clan
the
meetings, they had a picture of him with a circle and a slice right. through it, right?
And then the Filipino guy, Manny something.
Yes, Manny Pacquiao.
Pacquiao.
Yeah, he's one of my favorites as well.
Okay.
Very exciting. But
And then there was a bantamweight in my favorite year with Peter O'Toole that I thoroughly enjoyed.
You know what? I actually haven't seen that, but I've heard good
I recommend.
Things.
I recommend it. It's super fun. Peter O'Toole, Mark Lynn Baker.
Oh, I'm a fan of
Strangers.
One of those gentlemen.
Yeah, Perfect Strangers fame.
Roy Jones Jr. was my all-time favorite. He's one of the most spectacularly, naturally gifted athletes of all time. Like, he was just so lightning quick, and he was brash and cocky, but not in a dickish way, in a very sort of knowing, winking, fun way.
So he had the good personality, which seems to be something that boxers need to have too, right?
Yeah, I mean, he wasn't quite Ali levels of, like, gab and shit-talking, but he was good. And he would just do these ridiculous, like, he would put his hands down against the ropes and, like, you know, beckon his opponent towards him. And then the guy would come forward. And then he would, like, whip his one arm out and, like, drop the guy with a body shot.
Wow. When did he fight?
He fought through the 90s. For about 10 years, he was the pound-for-pound best on Earth. And it's always struck me as weird. Before he came to the ring, he rapped. Because he was sort of trying to be a musician at one point. So he rapped his own theme song wearing a mic on his way to the ring and then fought. Which is odd because it's like, hey, while you're waiting for me to be spectacular at something, why not watch me be mediocre at this other thing?
At this other thing that I'm actually not particularly good at.
He once had, speaking of his walkout theme, he was at Radio City Music Hall fighting a guy. And he came out. And Method Man and Red Man came out with him, and
okay.
they were big. It was the 90s. And
yeah.
All I can think is, like, the poor bastard he's fighting, like, sitting in his dressing room. Like, there's legitimately a chance he could have been listening to Method Man, like, on his Walkman or whatever. And then just like, oh, he's friends with those guys.
Oh, he's friends with those guys.
The guy that wants to beat me up is friends with.
And did he win most? And you said he was the best in the world. So was
he was undefeated for about 40 fights or so. He once, the only time in recorded boxing history... which they only started recording it, I would say, like 50 years ago, these stats. But he fought a round against a guy where the other guy did not land a single punch on him.
Oh,
it's the
wow.
only time he ever, no other fighter has done that, where the other guy could not hit him one time.
Holy smokes.
Yeah.
And so he fought through the 90s. There was a question I had. It was about...
He could beat up Godzilla.
He could be in a world. So punching Tom Hanks is about who can fight other people.
You segueing seamlessly.
I know it, because the thing is one of my favorite how to beat up anything was Batman.
Oh yeah,
you wrote a piece about how to beat Batman, and if I remember correctly, it was something like you had to become very close to Batman for 45 years, and then you had to take your chance, and then you would. Still lose because it was Batman.
Well, no, that one, you're very close, Jackie. I wish you'd went over the materials.
Oh, I really wish.
Messaged them over
again,
this
again. Aisha Tyler wished that I knew that she was on Archer.
That was where you sort of befriend him, hang out with him, forget about it, like put out of your mind that you're going to beat up the Batman. You
right?
need to kind of ingratiate yourself with
Batman.
Him for about 10 or 12 years hang out with him. And then on that morning of the 12th day, you need to like pick him up, hurl him into the sun, and then hit him with your heat vision. The little caveat, you need to be Superman for this one to work.
Oh my God, I forgot about the caveat, which
the
is the
twist-a-roo.
Greatest. Spoiler alert, Superman is introduced at the end of that story.
Still by the book, though.
Still by the book, yeah. Because it's, and I will link the book on the notes.
Oh.
So, I love the idea that, so Roy Wood Jr., stand-up comedian.
Sure, yeah.
Is also a boxer. So so you say that Roy, what's his name?
Jones.
Roy Jones
Jr. Jr. also.
There we go, Jr. as well. Yeah. Roy Jones Jr., an amazing athlete.
Yeah.
Do you think he could have played other sports?
He definitely could have, and he even played while he was fighting. There was a period where he was so sort of either bored legitimately and trying to challenge himself or being a dick. Where he would play in like a triple A or double A basketball league game before the actual fight. Like he would play in the game and then
we'd
fight
do like
that
a
night.
Giant pickup, like a professional pickup game.
Yeah, whatever triple A is.
In his,
not professional,
in,
but close
right,
or whatever.
Right,
yeah.
But,
so he was really
so he played,
that good.
That is amazing.
And he was such an athlete to where it was unfortunate because you have some guys like Ali who are really technically good at boxing. And then so when their reflexes go, they still have the fundamentals and can do things the right way and go longer. Like, he did things that you should not have been able to do because he was so fast. Like, fighting, he would fight with his hands down around his waist, right in your face, and then he would bring his hands up faster than you could if you had your hands in a regular stance, and he would hit you 3 or 4 or 5 times before you could even do anything. But then once his skills went, like, he had no technical ability to fall back on, so once he slipped a little bit and he was human... In the physical sense, he kind of got knocked out by a lot of guys. And then he's still sort of, it's sad. He's still like fighting in like Russia at like 4 a.m. I'll get up on Twitter and check. It's like, oh, my hero from the 90s got knocked out again.
Got knocked out.
Life is cruel.
Life is cruel. But that's amazing that he was so physically like a Superman kind of guy that didn't have to have that technicality.
Yeah. 8, 9, 10 punch combinations.
Who's the greatest technical fighter ever, do you think?
I mean, this is a little bit me repeating what I've heard because I don't have that depth of knowledge. But Sugar Ray Robinson supposedly is the best fighter of all time. And a lot of that was his technical ability and skills. I mean, he had everything in every way. And I've seen footage, but I mean, it'd be...
And I've heard of him.
It'd be fake for me to, you know, posit it as if I cobbled together this opinion on my own. It's purely, it's a little bit before my time, obviously.
Right. And it's something that was that was spoken.
Yeah.
Is that he was... Have you ever seen old footage of him fighting?
Yeah, yeah, and it's pretty spectacular, even considering
now?
The advances in, like, size and, you know, drug use and whatever else is going on. Like, he still looks pretty damn tough.
Now, are there steroid checks in boxing? Does anyone care if those guys are using steroids?
They do, but I think it's beyond, I think they're
it's
kind
too
of...
late?
It's just, they're not good at it, and they're not going out of their way to especially catch
people. Well, because the only place that they seem to really care is baseball, right?
Yeah, I don't know much about baseball or anything at all about baseball.
Well, but the thing is
I know they're bases and balls.
Right, but clearly in football, those guys are monsters.
Yeah.
They are taking something. They are taking some sort of body-enhancing drugs, and no one seems to be going, oh, that's unfortunate, that giant linebacker guy, he's throwing away the honor of the game by taking steroids. You're like, no, it's football, he gets to.
All those guys have that voice that you just did, too.
And so, yeah, that's,
hey,
it's my only... That is my one impression. Why am I not on Saturday Night Live? Why?
I think because boxing and, to a degree, mixed martial arts, they're such fringe sports. And boxing, it's like followed by 50-year-old, 60-year-old white dudes from the... You know what I mean? It's like, right. It's not in the forefront of anyone's imagination or my imagination.
It used to be huge. It's just not popular. Was it more popular than it is today?
Globally, it's very popular right now. But okay. In America, it was, yeah, way more popular, I think, during Ali and even during Sugar Ray Leonard's era during the 80s because it was on network TV. And once it went off network TV, people sort of stopped watching it. And you couldn't really make stars anymore. The last star would be... I mean, there's one or two still every couple of years, like right. Manny Pacquiao, Floyd Mayweather, Oscar De La Hoya, but it's just okay. much harder because it's not, even in the Olympics, like people fell in love with Sugar Ray Leonard because they watched the Olympics and saw him as a boy
right.
Achieving his dreams and then becoming a pro. Like, they don't even show the boxing now. They
wow.
kind of, yeah. Maybe yeah. like at 4 a.m. again.
Okay, yeah. Again, that it's not the thing. Yeah, I like the idea of, have you been to a lot of live?
I have, yeah. I've seen Manny Pacquiao a bunch of times. And,
really?
Yeah.
Now, do you sit up front with a newspaper so the blood doesn't splash on you? Is it like that?
I have a fedora with a little press ticket in there. And
Please do.
No, I've sat ringside in, like, close to ringside in Atlantic City years ago, but most of the time with someone like Manny.
Is it moist? When you sit ringside,
damp.
It looks moist.
No, it's not any moist. It's exactly like any other sort of venue that you've been to.
Okay.
Concert.
Like going to see a band or whatever. But
yeah.
Because it feels like, because they're sweating so much.
It
in
is.
The movies.
Yeah.
So.
I actually recently, I went with Morgan Murphy, actually.
Okay.
We went to see, we both are huge fans of this guy, Gennady Golovkin? Yeah, Triple G. He's a super humble guy.
Who can clock somebody?
Yeah, who speaks in adorable broken English.
Okay.
And,
where's he from?
He is, I want to say Russia, but I know I confuse Ukraine with Russia a lot of the times. He's one of those Eastern
Soviet
European
bloc.
Soviet bloc, yeah.
Okay.
And yeah, he's super humble, but he's got like sledgehammers for fists and will just annihilate you. And we actually had some pretty good seats thanks to her fancy pants connections. But
right.
It's great. The thing you notice is like you see boxing on TV and it's just like, oh, a guy gets knocked out. Like, who cares? Change the channel. A car blows up. Somebody jumps off a roof. Like
right.
Die Hard, superheroes. It sort of pales, you know? But when you're in the room, it's like a visceral, there is like an electricity. There's like
yeah.
a charge. And then you sort of, there's that danger element. And then somebody gets punched and you hear it and feel it. And it's like, oh, right, this is a fight. Like
right.
these people are hitting each other and they're really good at it. And it hurts. And there is almost a tragic, it's just so heightened. It's almost like a drugged up feeling, I think, being there. Everything is raised up and it's just like, holy shit, this is serious. And
on TV, you can hear the sneakers more often than not. You can hear like
yeah.
the squeak of the shoes.
And they do a good job, but it's not quite the level of like imminent danger.
Like you can hear the glove connect with somebody's head.
Yeah.
And that's got to be like a gunshot. And then you're like, oh, that guy's going to fall down, I bet.
Yeah.
And then when they don't, is that
the
shocking?
The triumph
or
of the human spirit.
Does it feel like the triumph of the will?
I mean, I guess it depends, but it's often shocking. And it's much smaller. It's much more contained also. You know, you're always blown away by how tiny the ring is and the people. But
what's
it's a
regulation
experience.
Ring size? Is it small?
It varies. It's like you can get like an 18 by 24 foot one, and then there's smaller ones. Like a lot of times a guy who's a puncher who is just basically going to try and get in your face and throw punches until
right.
he gets tired. If he's facing a boxer or somebody who's going to move, you know, he'll try and get the contract to stipulate a much smaller ring, like a phone booth. They'll like refer to it as jokingly where
okay.
it's like it clearly favors this guy.
Right.
Or, and, you know, if you have a runner, then you have one of these giant rings where it's like two little dudes and they're kind of. You
right.
can never catch the other guy.
Okay, so it's not like a baseball field or a football field. There's no you have to fight in this size ring.
I'm sure there are parameters, and but it might vary state by state. There's no like national commission. But,
okay,
yeah,
and it probably varies because of I remember I did a stand up gig,
uh-huh.
and in the back room there was a ring.
Oh yeah,
and
okay.
they had it was a what divey one nighter right
yeah.
in North Dakota or something like that, and in the back. They had a ring where they were like, no, we have boxing matches on
that is fantastic.
Every other Thursday or something. And you're like, who are they? And they're like, they're just guys who come through town kind of like you are.
Wow.
And then they beat each other. We watch. It's nice.
And then you fell in love with one of them.
And I fell in love and I stayed there. And now I live in Minot, North Dakota. And because who doesn't want to live in Minot? Why not Minot? They say to themselves.
I have a long list of reasons I can get you.
That's a T-shirt that they sell in Minot.
Really?
Yeah. Why not Minot?
If you want to base your local economy and tourism on a rhyming, yeah.
There's
look
a
deeper,
yeah. And then they have T-shirts in the middle of Wisconsin. There's some town that's where the hell is. It all it says is where the hell is, and then the name of their town
is.
Yeah, I don't. No, no, I don't know what the. I can't remember the name.
Oh,
of the town.
Oh, okay.
Right, right. It's sort of like Austin. Keep it weird. With yeah. Portland. Keep it weird.
People, wait, they both have keep it weird as
yeah,
a slogan.
Yeah, they do. Yeah, they do. Did
that
you not know
crazy.
That?
No, I knew. Austin had it. I did not know. Who's the Johnny Come Lately? Who had it first?
Austin had it first. There's a Portland comic. The only reason I know this is because there's a Portland comic who opened for me in Austin, and he said, yeah, we stole that from you. But don't you think that's kind of weird?
That's horrible. That's just the most humiliating thing. Like, the whole thing of, like, a mantra or a slogan is, like, it's got to speak to something original. It doesn't
right.
have to be great, but it should be uniquely yours.
It should
not
be
like,
uniquely yours.
It's like another state. It's like Georgia stealing, like, see Mount Rushmore. So, you know what I mean? Like,
right.
that's how inapplicable it
but
is.
But the thing is, in Portland, they're just like, don't you think it's a little weird that we stole your son, your slogan?
Pretty weird. Yeah.
It was a...
No.
Damn it, I can't remember the name of the comic. I'm a jackass.
I would love it. Yeah, but, like, keep Portland strange would be a little bit more decorous. I like that there's, like, no subterfuge. It's like, no. Weird.
Nope.
Keep it weird.
No, no, it
weird,
rolls
literally
right
stealing
off the tongue.
It. Yeah.
It rolls right off the tongue.
Works for Austin.
It'd be really nice if it said,
bastard.
Keep Austin weird. They crossed it out
yeah.
and put Portland.
Yeah,
that
yeah,
would
yeah.
actually make me happier. Austin, I'm told, is overkeeping themselves weird.
They're no longer.
Yeah, they're like, we're fine.
They're It'll, kicking them out. The vampires yeah. and the hippies. And the,
yeah, they're just like, we're so weird, we don't even care anymore.
That's good.
Yeah,
that's
I don't
a
mind
true
that.
Sign of a, yeah.
Yeah.
Actual weirdness, perhaps, not courting it.
Right.
Not like shouting it from the rafters. I'm different.
It jumped the shark as soon as they were available at the airport anyway. So.
Oh.
Yeah.
Yeah.
The T-shirts. So, it's fine.
Oh, I follow you.
Yeah.
I got you.
Oh, yeah. You know where I'm going. So,
how's my icon? Do people stare at you the whole time? Or I'm trying to balance it up. I'm doing a 60-40 around the room and then back to
it's
you
pretty
with
good.
Eye contact.
It's pretty good. I think our Asperger's is bouncing off of each other. It's quite nice. It's quite nice. And but what about, here's my next question about boxing.
Mm-hmm.
And martial, because we haven't really talked about MMA.
A.
Is because how long do you get to do it? How long do you last?
Are you talking about career or
yeah.
a fight?
Career. Oh, yeah. How long's a
huh?
fight?
How about
is
that?
A fight an hour?
Like it a, is a fortnight. It
a
is a series.
Fortnight.
No.
It is it cricket?
It is a fight, a non-title fight in mixed martial arts is 3 5-minute rounds.
Okay.
A title fight is 5 5-minute rounds.
Wow.
A little longer.
Yeah, yeah.
And you can't, that's the thing. That's what kind of makes it so great. In my life, I've seen like, generations of fighters come and go numerous times. I mean, not clearly generations in the literal sense, but I mean...
The turnover is so...
Yeah, I mean, there were big guys who were big in the 90s. I would say you got about, best case scenario, like an 8-year career, maybe.
Okay.
Which
you feels
know?
Shorter than baseball or football or...
I think it is. I mean, you yeah. can be over... I mean, you can lose. I imagine your team can lose and it's not a big deal. You come back. It's like, that's what's so tragic and so... makes it so present is you know, you can lose a fight, 2 or 3 fights, and then your entire career is over. Everything you've been working towards. Like, some people, if you get hit and get knocked out, it just does something to your brain where you can't take it the same way again. Like, your career can be ruined in a fight.
Oh, it isn't the promoters. It's the actual fighter going, oh, that happened. And so they shy off a little bit.
Well, that, but then also a lot of times the fighter is the last person to want to admit that, and they still
yeah.
can find a way. I think it takes so much will and discipline and cockiness to do that, that...
To
so,
keep showing up?
Yeah. And
yeah,
to believe
like
that you can be the best out of all these other individuals takes a lot of balls. So when whatever it was that you had is gone, I think you believe it past where it's still realistic.
Right.
So a lot of times promoters will have to retire you. A lot
right.
of times promoters could be scumbags, though, and then try and exploit you because you still have a name.
Okay.
But yeah, you can...
They're like, yes, you can fight in this thing because people are going to come and watch you get beat up.
Yeah, and that's sort of been a sad thing that crosses over in boxing and MMA. You know, you see guys in their 40s kind of still making a living on like a local scene,
oof.
Getting knocked out by some local tow truck driver.
Right.
Know.
Do they go into I had a wrestling episode. And
I listened to that one in preparation for this. Yeah.
Oh, my God. That one,
I did some preparation. What do you think about that? Is that weird to you?
It is weird
find
to me.
That
I,
odd?
Find that, I find that interesting. I find that an interesting premise.
You find that Keep Portland weird? Is that...
I don't know. You know, I just...
Mike Schmidt was on the show.
This week's episode is the Vonnegut episode.
Oh, right.
And all I did to prepare for that was I printed out all of Vonnegut, the list of Vonnegut's books.
You son of a bitch.
I was like, but I did, but I didn't. Did you read Bluebeard? It turns out he did. And did you, because he's a Vonnegut dork. He's going to have read all of the books. But
I know how it works. Yeah. I like how you walk me through that. Now, wait a minute. So he doesn't know anything about Vonnegut. No, Kevin. He goes towards Vonnegut. We don't define him by what he doesn't.
But Judah Friedlander came on. He brought like.
What if you had like a hockey dork? Would they be into hockey? Or would they be, they go the other way. They're not into.
Oh no, they got to be into hockey. Okay. I had some guy who said, you know what I really hate? I want to come on and talk about what I really hate. And I said, no, that's not what the Dork Forest is about.
There's someone enough places else. For that in the world.
Yeah, there's plenty of places where you can slam something. Yeah. What I would like you to do is talk about the thing that you love. And if it's.
Who was that? Every comedian?
Every comedian I've ever met. No, it was a comic. I can't remember his name.
Of course it was. Of course it was a dude.
Right. It was some dude. Oh, it was the other night. And it was.
Oh, you don't have to if you don't
want to. No, I don't remember. I don't even remember his name. He went up at Hannibal's show and he said, oh, I'd love to come on and talk about how I hate the Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. Marvel's Agents
what
of S.H.I.E.L.D.
What an ass. And I'd say it's a good show. It's
first
trying.
Of all, I like it.
Yeah. And it's not perfect, but it's trying. It's
and
Joss
it's
Whedon.
In its first, and it's 10 episodes, so why don't you calm down?
Yeah. There's 100 people giving notes on that show, I would imagine.
Yeah.
Between Disney and Marvel.
And Marvel.
Cut him a break.
Yeah. It's way too much.
Out of all the shows, he hates that show. It's like, it's certainly not offensive or bad.
Right. Instead of spending some quality time on The Big Bang Theory, which every other comic is hating on.
Oh, I've never even seen that, so.
I've only seen it, I've never seen the words being, I've only seen it on mute.
Airport lounges.
I'm not even kidding.
Dentist offices.
My brother loves it, but I suspect his taste, because my brother Russ loves a lot of crap, and one of his favorite sitcoms of all time, 2 1/2 Men.
Oh.
So as an introduction to other sitcoms that I didn't enjoy 2 1/2 Men because it wasn't made for me.
I did not enjoy it. I have an uncle who's a big fan and will often like shoehorn conversations into
like he'll quote
describing plot. He'll tell me he'll walk me through an episode. There's a character named Alan I know from talking to him, and he'll kind of detail what happened with this other person. I don't know who the Sheen character was, but he loves it.
It really resonated with a certain type of human being.
The shittier it is to females, the more my uncle liked the particular episode.
And I didn't think my brother Russ was that big of a dick toward women, but he does. And I was like, how about how I Met Your Mother? That one's kind of shitty towards women, isn't it? And he was like, nah, I don't like that one too much. And I said, is there some kindness? Is there possibly some love at the end of it?
To fairness to your brother, he could just be not paying attention or be like, that's funny, and not realizing.
No,
the implications
and that is very
the woman
likely.
Hating underneath.
Very likely, because I'll tell you something about my brother is he will watch. He loves a shitty '60s beach movie like Annette Funicello, but the knockoffs.
Wow! Yeah.
And his DVR is full of crap, and he'll call me to tell me what he's watching. He said, "I want to write a book about." The business implications of different movies. Like, you know, like The Apartment is a great movie about infidelity in the corporate world. Executive Suite is a really shitty movie, but it has a great sort of subplot about the nature of corporate. And I was like, now I need to see Executive Suite.
Yeah.
But,
wait, what does he do for a living? He sounds like
he's an econ professor.
Okay.
And a money laundering. Yes.
I'm a dummy.
And it's fine. It's you didn't do any research into my family? It's fine.
No.
The Wikipedia page has been updated recently.
I'm going from this to your brother's podcast. So
it's women
in bikinis, so pretty good.
I have an episode with him that I recorded that I want to get all of my family. I want to do like everybody. And then my mom died and I was like, too late. And,
Sorry.
Yeah, me too. But, cause I missed out on, no, that's so great.
Golden episode
that would have been great about how much she loved Wizard of Oz. But let me segue into this. Are there great boxing movies? Are there mixed martial art movies? Drumline, is that a marching band movie?
I believe that's more about drums and lines and their age old rivalry. I mean, there were some decent ones, you know, Raging Bull or whatever. I enjoy the original Rocky's kind of a magical, amazing movie that sort of been tarnished by the sequels, which I also love.
But you still love the sequels?
I do.
Oh
my God.
The original movie is a great movie.
Yeah. And I've shown it to people who are like, oh no, Rocky 1 million, those kind of jokes. And they see it and they're blown away by how like touching and smart and sincere.
He doesn't win.
Yeah, exactly.
People forget that he does not win the game.
I never watched the whole thing, Jackie. Fuck.
Oh, spoiler alert from 1978.
Yeah, no, it's a beautiful... I would say that's the perfect boxing movie. But, you know, they never really... They're always unrealistic. I think they have to be because...
Because they're trying to portray something that's hard to show, I think.
Yeah. And then, you know, I will say, though, that Rocky was unrealistic for many years. And then there was a fighter by the name of Arturo Gatti who had a series of fights with this guy, Micky Ward, the guy who was the basis for The Fighter, the motion picture,
okay.
Mark Wahlberg.
Mm-hmm.
And the common remark about that their trilogy of fights was like it was like a real Rocky movie. And it was true. I mean, they almost took the unrealistic aspects of a Rocky movie and... raise the bar for every other boxer. I mean, it was just brutal round after round of them standing there punching each other and not falling down
and not falling
rallying
down.
Rallying and bleeding. And so, but yeah.
There is some problem where they have to call it because they're killing each other. Isn't that part of it?
Yeah, yeah.
Was that 10 years ago that they had to, that several people were dying or?
I mean, occasionally someone will die. And unfortunately, recently there was someone who was in a coma for a couple of days after a fight and, yeah, I mean, that's sort of part of, it's like, it's sort of hard to reconcile that side of it, you know? It's not the prettiest thing to think about, but it's...
It can't be surprising, though, just because of the nature of the game.
Yeah, I mean, it's not a safe sport, and that is always a possibility. It's not, like, likely, it doesn't usually happen, but it happens now and again, and they try and make it as safe as possible, and they've shortened fights from what they used to be, you know?
Okay.
You know, around the turn of the... Previous century,
right.
Around the 1900s, it was, you know, you could go like 80, 90 rounds, and now it's,
right.
They're all, and then it was even 15 rounds up until the 70s, and now it's just 10, 12 rounds is
it's
the
12
cap.
Rounds?
Yeah.
And how long are each rounds in
3 minutes.
3 minute rounds.
Yeah.
Wow. Okay, so they're fighting for 40 minutes.
Yeah. They're fighting for an episode of a TV show.
Right, and because they're sitting down in the middle of it all, but they're...
Yeah, they get to sit down? Hey, what the hell?
Well, don't
screw
they go in the
them.
Corner and somebody throws a bucket of water at them and
they do. They get to
the
sit
blood.
Down for 1 minute after every three.
After every three rounds?
No, after every round, three minutes, there's 1 minute rest period.
Oh, okay.
Sit, yeah.
Oh, good. And so when you hit somebody in the head, are you trying to hit them in the jaw? Or are you trying to hit them in the brain box?
Eyeballs. You always ain't... No.
Why
do you have a legit, like, interesting...
Interesting? Is that what they're doing?
Yeah, basically the jaw is where you would typically try and go. I mean, you go to the body, you can go to the chest, but the body shots will really hurt you. And then the jaw can hurt you. But even high on the head, the high on the temple here is a good shot where you can see guys get knocked out. Top of the head, obviously no good. Back of the head's illegal. But anywhere in the face or jaw... You know, even like dead on square in the face, you can see in a slow-mo, like a guy will go down from that. But the jaw is typically the one where there's something in there that just sends a message to your brain, like, oh, shut it down. We're gonna take a break.
That is interesting that it is, because that would be the only reason to hit somebody in the jaw. I mean, it kind of looks cool, right, to really clock somebody in the jaw, but there must be some sort of message center there.
Yeah, I mean, that is what a knockout is. It's like your brain... is taking too much trauma, and it sends a message, I guess, like a survival instinct. Which
right,
I don't
right.
know how laying there unconscious is really going to help the guy, but it's sort of an old fight-or-flight type thing where it just shuts you down, and it's you drop.
At the very least.
Yeah.
Maybe they'll just go, oh, we're done here, and keep moving, unless you're a lion, and then you're like, oh, good, now I can eat this.
Yeah.
And, wow. So, but if you hit them in the body, then there might be internal injuries, or...
I don't know the science behind that. There's definitely something where, I've been hit in the gut, and I've been hit in I think it's the kidneys.
Okay.
There's liver punches and kicks in MMA.
Is that the side near the back?
Yeah. In the stomach, it just knocks the wind right out of you.
Right.
Where you just can't breathe, you can't do anything, and you just kind of go into the fetal position.
Right.
I've been hit harder to the body than I have to the head. Like, the head punches don't... It sounds bravado-ish, but bravado-ish. It sounds overly macho,
bravado-like,
but bravado-esque. But head punches never hurt, and I've been hitting the head a bunch. Like body punches, I was hitting the chest once with this Russian guy we were sparring in not doing headshots.
Right,
and it's like, oh, okay. And he was like this kind of bigger dude, like 220.
Right,
and he hit me to the body, and it felt like I was being electrocuted, like straight in the chest. And
right.
like I tried not to
like
show
sternum?
Anything.
Sternum.
Yeah, right in the middle of the sternum, and it was like I was electrically shocked. And immediately you're sort of like scared and like you just kind of want to like not be here, and you just kind of keep walking around and keep a straight face, and then like I tried to move back and make it so he didn't hit me again immediately and possibly turn me into dust,
right?
But like a vampire,
like all of your bones were shaking or something, or
I don't know what it was like scientifically, but it was it just felt like it was just a shock. It was just such a blow, and that hurt worse than anything I've ever felt in like boxing and stuff,
right? Right, and so now in mixed martial arts, they can kick you.
They can kick you, head kicks, body
head kicks.
Yeah.
And can they kick you like in the shoulder? I mean,
they can.
Is it in mixed martial arts, are there, this is probably true in boxing too, where if you fall down, that's a point or something, right?
Mm-hmm.
What is the scoring in boxing versus mixed martial arts? Do you know what the score is?
Boxing, it's sort of nebulous, which is unfortunate, but they base who wins a round on aggression, defense, ring generalship. A series of factors like that.
Okay.
But ultimately, you decide who wins the round, and you give that person 10 points, you give the loser 9 points. If there's a knockdown, the person who's knocked down gets 8 points. If he gets knocked down twice, it's 7 points. In mixed martial arts, they have sort of a similar ranking. There's no knockdowns don't automatically count because people get knocked down, people get taken down by wrestlers.
Right.
It's a really bad scoring system. They kind of just took the boxing one, and they kind of need to overhaul it because it's not applicable because there's too many other aspects.
There's so many different ways that you can attack, right?
Yeah,
so.
And it's not as simple as just 10-9 because, you know, you could have somebody take somebody down, but the other guy punches him more before that happens, but then he almost chokes him out but doesn't. And then it's like, well, who – it's like you have to find a way to adequately – address it. It's not as simple as just he hit him more and hurt him more.
And in mixed martial arts, there's no pinning, is there?
No.
Like
there's
like
no
wrestling.
Pinning. Okay, well, in boxing, there's like if you can't get up at the 10 count, you lose.
At the 10 count, you lose.
In mixed martial arts, there's none of that. The referee can stop it at any time.
Okay.
If you get knocked out, if you're unconscious, they stop it. Mm-hmm. If you're taking punches, you can't defend yourself, they stop it. And if you tap out, when you're being submitted.
Okay.
That's like a way
it's
to
like call. It's like I'm done.
Yeah. Like you either tap your own body.
Is that what tap out is?
Yeah. You tap your body or your opponent's body or the mat and then you end it.
The hell is that t-shirt?
That horrible douchebag brand tap out clothing.
Is it the name of the brand? Is that the brand?
That is the brand.
Okay. Because all I know, I get most of my information from people doing stand-up comedy jokes about different things.
Hey, that guy came back with that voice.
And
Yeah, that guy just came in.
It'll be a nice drinking game for all Rangers of the Dork Forest when you hear me do that voice. It's my dumb voice.
When Lou shows up or...
Yeah, Lou. Lucation. And what's going to happen? And
wait, I interrupted. Sorry, what was your
point? No, but that's what the tap-out thing is.
Yes,
because you can essentially say, I surrender.
Yeah.
That's what tapping out is.
Yes.
Okay.
Which is great because there's not that overly macho... There's no stigma to it. You know what I mean? Like, these guys are risking their lives and it's sort of...
It's just an acknowledge of... No, I'm going to live to fight another day kind of thing.
Which is great. And that's a smart thing to have. And I wish more people in boxing sort of... I wish there was more of a boxing equivalent where you could quit and you weren't like called a pussy by people.
Right.
In, you know...
I think I saw a Warren Beatty, Barbara Streisand boxing movie where she threw a towel in.
Yeah, that's...
Yeah.
I think technically that's illegal now, but you can still do it. I think that was the main event, right?
Yeah. It was called the main event. That's exactly what that was. And... Okay, so here was my other... There was a boxing question about... What was it? Could have been anything.
There's gloves. There's pants. There's walkout music.
There's walkout music?
Well, I mean, you know, when you're walking to the ring, you want to have some sort of intimidating...
Oh, right.
Yeah.
Maybe that's why they keep asking comedians what they want to be brought up to.
Yeah, but isn't... Well, don't you... I used to love that, though, man. Like, coming out at, like, Largo or something with a cool song.
With a cool song?
Yeah. Don't you do that even...
People ask me... whenever anybody asks me what song I want, I always say Eminem's White America. Just because it makes me laugh.
I mean, you do the clubs for a living. I mean, I did a handful of them back when my, you know, younger days. But I remember I did, like, the improv at Irvine.
Yeah.
And I'd done mainly, like, alternative rooms prior to that. And I had no idea. Maybe you're used to it. But it was, like, Wayne Fetterman was on the show, and I was the host. And he brought me in. And it was, like, the intro for me was, like... There was, like, the music. It was like I'd won the Stanley Cup. There's a spotlight. I think a smoke machine. A fucking, like, DJ voice. Like, here we go, ladies and gentlemen. Are you ready? And, like, gong, gong, gong. Like, loud, throbbing lights. Yeah. And then I come out just like, I'm just going to be telling jokes. Like, I don't have, like,
I'm not fighting a tiger. I have 15 minutes here. Right. I wish you were fighting.
Do they still do that? That seems so overblown and, like, unnecessary.
Oh, yeah. They still do that. It's even the same song.
Wow.
You know what comedy clubs don't do? They don't fix something if it's not broken, they say to themselves.
Get hyped up to laugh at jokes
that they don't. And then the biggest problem, Maria does a joke about how nobody knows what they're going to see when they see stand-up comedy.
Oh,
they're like,
yeah.
Oh, it's just going to be comedy. And you're like, but what kind of comedy is it? Is it
one of the basic human emotions will be. Yeah.
Right. Is it the comedy I like, which is, you know, caustic one-liners from sumo-sized wrestlers? Or is it going to be, you know, storytelling from in a very dry tone of voice?
It's so ridiculous. Just comedy.
Yeah. You're like, feel free to Google the name of the comic you are going to see, my friends, so that you know what you are seeing. What I was going to ask you about. Gambling.
Right.
There's more gambling with boxing, I know, than other things, isn't there?
There is a decent amount of, there's gambling. I don't know how it equates or whatever, but it's fun to gamble on the fights.
Yeah.
I've done it a little bit, poorly.
And right, because you now, do you bet on who wins, or do you bet on, is there a spread?
You can bet on who wins, you can bet on whether it's a draw, and you can bet on like how it ends and which round it ends.
Okay.
That kind of thing.
You can get minutia.
Before that, yeah, totally. I used to do, back in LA, I would have like people come over and watch like pay-per-views, and we'd make like a big chart, and we would do a thing where you could just pick, everybody puts rounds into a hat and pulls them out, and everybody puts in like $10. And then if somebody loses in that round, the guy you have, you would get like the whole pot or whatever.
Oh, wow.
It's fun.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
It's a good time, you know?
Yeah, that breaks it up. Does that make the game more fun or less fun to watch?
I think it always adds to it. Yeah.
Yeah?
Yeah.
Okay.
Definitely.
Yeah, because I know that my father, that's what he bet on the boxing. That's why he needed to watch them all the time.
Yeah.
Because I don't know that he likes boxing or football or anything. I know he likes to gamble. So I think that there's people who like the sport, and then there's people who like betting on the sport, and then there's that overlap. There's a Venn diagram of people who like to just bet on the sport because they like the sport.
Debilitating problems that will be their undoing.
People who are
fans
fringe.
On the other side into the purity of the game, and in the middle, there's
There's a nice crossover of people who enjoy eating wings as well as watching the game.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, like,
I think wings covers everyone, doesn't it? That's sprinkled all over the two circles. It's just a smattering of wings.
I think when you go on out to the fringe of the wing people, that's an eating disorder. And then you go on the other side, you have the purity again.
Oh, yeah.
So that was my wing gambling analogy.
Okay.
Sure. What the heck?
Yeah. I feel like often like jealous as a boxing fan because it doesn't have so much of what the mainstream sports does, whether it's coverage or the attention. But a big one is like, I feel like for the past 5 years, most of my jock friends are obsessed with, and I know nothing about sports, but are obsessed with like fantasy football or fantasy baseball.
Yeah.
And I wish there was like the equivalent for boxing or mixed martial arts. There was actually a thing maybe 15 years ago. There was a short-lived league that I joined up with. It was sort of a thing where you could pick the fighters and you would get points over the season based on whether they won or lost. And it was a similar theory, but it just doesn't really work because they don't play with the same, they don't fight with the same regularity that a baseball player
plays. So it's hard to make the stats and stuff.
Yeah, because you can fight maybe two times a year sometimes only.
Okay.
You know?
Yeah, Jimmy Pardo calls fantasy baseball, which he plays, fantasy accounting. And
doesn't he go? He gets like hardcore about it, right?
Yeah, yeah.
He goes
he's
to
very
Vegas
hardcore.
And they rent a room. And,
Oh yeah. But I think that there probably is some sort of fantasy boxing thing. You should tweet at Kevin Seccia if you know about fantasy boxing.
I'll join your league.
There might be fantasy because people know about this stuff. I get emails, long emails of people telling me very specific things of what of the shows, and they're great because. I do a note session, which means that I listen to the show and I try to link people to different, like, if you want to watch boxing, what channels are you watching? ESPN only?
No, HBO, Showtime is really good nowadays.
Oh, a lot of pay-per-view.
Yeah, all pay-per-view and then ESPN2.
Okay.
Also, Fox Sports 1 is a new network that has a lot of boxing on it. The UFC it's been pretty great, actually, the past couple of years because they finally got a deal with Fox. So now you can watch it on the actual Fox network once every couple of months. And then also Fox Sports 1 and Fox Sports 2 and in addition to pay-per-view. But you can watch it on like free TV now, which is great.
Oh, just regular network television will show UFC stuff.
Yeah, yeah.
And now with mixed martial, let's talk a little bit about that. Mm-hmm. Just one guy fighting another guy or do they have tag teams or is it...
Oh my God, I wish they would be tag teams. That's so amazing. Yeah. It is typically, yeah, it's not typically, it is 100% always a man versus another man or a woman versus another woman.
Okay. And with the women version of it, yeah. is there any stigma to that? Or are people just like, no, women get to do it. Nobody cares anyway. We're going to watch this.
There was a stigma for a while, and it was sort of this second class sport. And I think the evolution of that has kind of taken off in leaps and bounds. And even a couple of years ago, you'd find people who were made uncomfortable by it and sort of...
Yeah.
I don't know if you'd call it sexist, but the idea of seeing women get hit. And also, I think, honestly, at the time, that sport had been around less time than the men's version. So the evolution, it hadn't quite... They weren't as good overall.
They're both so new... That and the women one was even newer.
Yeah.
Yeah.
But women's MMA has taken off in leaps and bounds over the past year and a half due to the emergence of this amazing superstar, Ronda Rousey, who is one of my favorite fighters.
Wow.
Who she is just, like, everyone was sort of, like, very Miss America-ish prom queen, very polite, very humble. And she kind of came along and was brash and called out the champion of this defunct organization called Strikeforce.
Right.
Was, like, 4-0 at the time, 5-0. Every one of her, she's an Olympic judo medalist.
Okay.
And every one of her wins was by throwing the person on the ground and getting them in a move called the armbar and submitting them.
Oh, wow.
Which is unheard of because you don't win every fight by one maneuver.
Right.
So she beat that champion and then was so popular that basically the UFC decided to create their version of the women's division.
Okay.
Because she's so exciting and outspoken and she's got a lot of mainstream press. Have you heard of her at all?
No, I haven't.
Oh, it's surprising. She's done a lot of like talk show stuff and kind of taken off. And so, yeah, she's had a couple of fights now in the UFC and she's just magnificent. Like just someone
just
who
an amazing athlete.
Yeah. Who was conditioned from a young age to be great at judo by her mom, who was a judo champion and brought her up very tough. And she's like, you know, very sort of dynamic and outgoing and attractive, which is sort of, you know, a component which people focus on maybe more than
fit.
They should.
You're very fit, but she has very much regular features. Like
she looks very, not quite model-esque, but she's a very attractive woman. And I think people maybe focus on that more than they should, but you get it, I guess.
But you want to have a good looking, like there was the, I think Oscar De La Hoya.
Yeah, it works for men too. Like they'll exploit you. They don't care what your gender is, honestly.
Yeah, that's a
Oscar
pretty guy.
Oscar De La Hoya
guy.
Was huge because of his looks.
He was super handsome.
And he drew all these female fans that didn't care before that. And
I only knew who he was because he was handsome.
Yeah.
Because I don't, So she, and so there are enough other women fighters to fight this woman. Currently the champion?
She's currently the champion. She just had a rematch with the woman she won the old title from.
Right.
And beat her.
Okay.
And
she's still using that
8-0,
same move?
Same everything with the armbar.
Wow.
Unbelievable. But her next fight, which is in February, and you should consider checking it out, it's sort of intriguing because her opponent, for the first time, she's facing someone with a strong base like hers. She's facing a silver medalist in wrestling.
Okay.
Yeah. This woman, Sara Mcmann, who's sort of raw, doesn't have the experience Ronda does, but it's sort of... She could, in theory, nullify Ronda's ability to get that move or
that
get it on the
ground. That actually sounds kind of exciting.
Two undefeated women. Yeah.
Yeah.
Headlining a pay-per-view. So it's been a huge year for women's MMA.
Yeah, that sounds fascinating.
Yeah.
And it's weird to me that armbar thing is undefensible.
It's not. That's the thing. It isn't. It wasn't prior to this. That's what's so funny. It's like we've seen... Lots of dudes use it. Lots of women use it. And sometimes it works. Sometimes the person gets out of it. It's never been this... It's almost like a pro wrestling thing, like in the 80s, where like once a guy hit their finishing move, like the DDT or the Paldar, like that's it. Nobody gets up from it. It's sort of like that mentality.
Right.
Only it's real, which is so exciting. It's like she gets it on and then you're fucking done. Like you can get out of it, but then she'll get you in it later.
Right.
And everything... Every move, I saw some video that somebody put together where she's always thinking like 3 or 4 moves ahead. Like if you grab her, you can tell. It was a judo guy broke it down. Like she's already, she even said it. She's like, when I grab you, when the fight starts, when I grab you, all I see is a series of moves that I'm going to make you do. Like if you go this way and I want you to go this way, I'm going to do this. And I'm going to keep doing that, manipulating you until you only have two choices, which is to tap or break your arm.
Oh, wow.
So it's like she wants your leg to be over here, she'll do this, and then your leg goes over. So from there, she can, like, flip you down, and now you're on the ground. And then
so
when you try and defend, like, she's, like, thinking 4 or 5 moves ahead. Yeah, it's very scientific.
That is amazing.
Yeah.
It's, wow.
You should YouTube the fight of her, any of her fights. They're always sort of interesting.
And what's her name again?
Ronda Rousey.
Ronda Rousey. What does that mean? Who
it's
names
her name?
Kid?
Then... Ronda?
Yeah, yeah. Her mom, is she... She white?
you racist.
I mean, again with the race. It always comes back. Yeah, I'm just always interested in where, because the thing is her mom was a judo.
You want to know if you can like her, if she's your race.
Well, that is true. Is she Armenian with a half Irish
She actually
twist?
Trains with a lot of Armenians, and she has one of her gyms in Glendale.
That's because you want to punch an Armenian. That's why.
Wait, aren't you Armenian?
I am Armenian. Yes. So I like that. That was a laugh against your will, by the way. You're like, I used to live around a lot of Armenians. And so, anyway.
She is white, blonde, all-American looking. I don't know her ethnicity, but...
Because I don't know what Rousey is. What's the ancestry
what
of that?
Is that?
And then who names a kid Ronda? Because the alliteration on that is insane.
Yeah.
Ronda Rousey.
You could go again. Ronda, it depends. Yeah.
It's like, I had an aunt, Kathy Kashian.
Oh.
And, but she married into it. And you're like, ugh. What's your middle name? Elizabeth? I would have gone with something else.
Yeah, that's a little bit too much.
Yeah, yeah.
Her nickname, Rowdy.
Rowdy. Oh, yeah. Of course. That makes sense, too. Rowdy Ronda Rousey.
Correct.
Yeah.
Look her up. I think you'd enjoy her.
It sounds fascinating. It's so there's a fight in February. And are there pay-per-view fights every month or every couple of months?
Pretty much every month now. Boxing, it's a little bit less. There's only a couple of big stars in boxing that can do that.
Generate it?
Yeah, exactly. But with mixed martial arts, it's more about the whole card as opposed to individual stars. So UFC is roughly every month, sometimes twice a month.
Okay.
And sometimes it's free TV, sometimes it's pay-per-view, you know.
And do you usually pay?
I do, and it sucks because in Los Angeles, I had a lot of friends who liked boxing. And
you could kind of mix it up.
And now I'm just such a fan that I'm literally just on my couch by myself usually paying $60, $70.
Because it costs 60 or 70 bucks?
It does, yeah.
Okay.
But I'm such a, like,
I don't
want to miss it.
I thought it was 20 bucks. That's interesting. Are they...
But no one I know likes it. I think it's a New York thing, maybe. Maybe because I used to hang out with more comics. I don't know. None of my friends in New York really give a shit about it. They'll come over once in a while. Like, a lot of, actually, my best friend, this woman, Ariel Schrag... is a big fan of Ronda Rousey. I feel like a lot of women, obviously, are drawn to her. So for her fights, it's always packed. Like, there's like a dozen people who come over and watch.
Right.
Mostly women. Mostly lesbians, oddly.
Yeah.
They love Ronda Rousey.
And they're very supportive of each other.
Yeah.
Because ladies are supportive. They're doing it for themselves.
Yes.
This episode is full of Jackie making sweeping statements about race.
Broad generalizations.
Yes. Yeah. What else can I do? And... I've been running around New York so much that I'm genuinely just punchy. I'm just like, how do I get to the thing with the thing? And everyone's like, there's an app. And I said, stop telling me there's an app. I have four apps. Fuck you with the apps.
Well, you have a Maps app that came with your phone, right? Just use that.
The Maps app doesn't do... The Map app on the iPad wants me to have another app.
Oh. What about iPhone?
I don't have an iPhone. I have a Go phone. I have a burner, just in case I got to drop off the grid, man.
What are you... Wow, when do you pick up the package from Bodhi? And
I have that iPad, and I just downloaded... What I have is I have HopStop, which it is...
That's supposed to work.
Right, yeah. But it is mocked openly. Oh. I have something called Life Trip or something like that, and it only has maps of New York, London, and Paris. It seems very glamorous.
Ooh, la la.
And then a comic from here, J.F. Harris, said... Why don't you just get the Google Map app in Lou's voice?
Yeah.
He goes, why wouldn't you just fucking get
that's what I use.
Yeah. And so that's what I have now. And that one seems to work really well, quite honestly.
Yeah.
Google Map app.
I use. I hate because it'll often reset when I'm like fucking underground and I need these directions.
Right.
But here's what I do. A little tip is I'll take a photograph of it. So then I still have it even if it resets.
Like a screensaver kind of situation? Can you do that?
I know with the iPhone, if you hit the power button and the little top thingy, it takes a picture of your screen. I don't know.
Oh, it's a screenshot. Power button and the...
I'm sure that has the same capability.
Right. Well, I was going to tell you the name of this app. The London-Paris one makes me laugh. Oh, it's called City Mapper. And what you can do on City Mapper is you can save an offline.
Are these your sponsors?
These are my sponsors. Please, I wish. City Mapper.
You can save... Oh, that's good. Yeah.
You can save your current trip and then you can just look it up later.
Yeah.
And you know what's... Yeah, people, if you want a sponsor, if you think the Dork Forest might be interested, that my listeners might be interested in what you sell, feel free to email me at jackie@jackiekashian.com and find out about sponsorship. That was the ad. Okay, now, so let us leave us with a couple of places where people should... Would you recommend going to see live boxing? Do you think that might get people into it?
Yeah, absolutely. If you live in Los Angeles, New York, especially, the Barclays Center is very
Minot?
Good for fights.
Yeah?
Yeah. Connecticut. Mashantucket Casino.
Oh, really?
You know,
casinos sometimes will set up a giant ballroom and
yeah.
How many people go to a boxing match?
27 every fight.
Every fight.
No,
27
hundreds to thousands. It varies.
Yeah. Okay, but yeah. it can be as little as a couple hundred.
Yeah. Oh, definitely.
Okay.
Like a little what they call like a club fight. You know,
yeah.
Like a club. You know, like a.
That's awesome.
Yeah.
This has been fascinating. I know nothing about this kind of thing. All I know is. There's some hitting, but there's clearly athleticism going on.
Yeah.
You'll
find some athleticism. I don't know why I got all gung-ho.
Well, because it's the Dork Forest.
Yeah.
Kevin Seccia, thank you so much for being on the Dork Forest. People should go to @KevinSeccia for Twitter.
Yes.
And you're probably on Facebook and Instagram and Vine.
I don't really bother with Facebook in any professional capacity.
Okay, fair enough.
Instagram, sure. Twitter, my website, buy my book, Punching Tom Hanks. Soon to be available in audio form.
Are you going
to
read it?
Via the good people at Earwolf. I'm going to read a little, and then we're going to get a bunch of people to read it.
Cool.
I was lucky enough to get some fancy celebrity rebuttals in the first book, so hopefully I can get them to kind of read versions.
Oh, that is awesome.
Yeah.
Okay. Thanks a lot for listening, everybody. Take care out there. Bye. Okay, well, that was incredible. Feel free, by the way, to listen to the bonus content on tdf.libsyn.com or on the app. For some reason, Libsyn is just putting it on tdf.libsyn.com. So you can do that. And you can go to iTunes and subscribe, which is what a lot of people do. And then they write reviews, and iTunes is supposedly caring about that. So the other information you should know is I'm doing Sketchfest in San Francisco at the end of January, beginning of February. And then I'm going to be in Palm Springs. Yes, at the Improv at Palm Springs. Also the first week of February. So go to JackieCation.com and check my comedy schedule to see if I'm coming to a city near you. There's also on JackieCation.com and DorkForest.com a donation button. Because we had a sponsor doesn't mean you shouldn't donate. If you can, $8.33 a month. That's $100 a year. Or you can just throw me $100. That'd be great. If everyone gave me $100 a year, I would be very excited and solvent. Because stand-up comedy, while wonderful, isn't great. Anyway, so other than that, if you just want to order stuff, you can order it at JackieCation.com or through the Amazon banner at JackieCation.com. You order stuff, regular stuff from Amazon, but you go through that portal on JackieCation.com and I get a tiny kickback and we all win. The credits, of course. Patrick Brady, gonna fix this audio. Mike Rickberg sang that song, composed it and sang right there at the beginning. He's singing the Mexican hat dance at the end of the show. Vilmos fixes the website. Vilmos has his own podcast called Green Room Radio. Feel free to listen to that. Anyway, the longest outro in the world. You are loved. The universe supports you. Be good to each other out there. And I'll try my damnedest to be good to everybody as well. Take care. Bye.
My hat, my hat, my hat. They're dancing around my hat. My hat, my hat, my hat. Well, what do you think of that? If it looks like a Mexican hat dance and it sounds like a Mexican hat dance, it's most likely a Mexican hat dance. So take off your hat and let's dance.
Yay! Oh my God. Why don't we just call that as the end of the show?